Amen.
Heavenly Father, thank you for all the gifts that you give us, especially the gift of our name. We ask you to send the Holy Spirit upon our little theological chit-chat tonight. Open our minds and our hearts. Father, we have to talk about some difficult things tonight, so we ask for the Holy Spirit in a special way. But we ask you to get us to the hopeful, consoling parts about our faith, and fill us with the hope and the tension toward eternal life tonight. We place our whole lives, our struggles, our cares, our concerns, our joys, our sufferings in the hands of the Blessed Virgin Mary, who promises to pray for us now and at the hour of our death. And we say together, Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Our Lady, start the new evangelization.
Pray for us.
St. Mark,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hey, everybody, thanks for letting me come talk about hell. This will be fun. Somebody said right before I started, hey, give us some good news tonight, would you? I will, I promise. In about 1 hour, we'll get to the good news. But I want to start out, I'm not even into icebreakers. When I'm sitting in a group, I hate icebreakers. But this is kind of the greatest icebreaker ever. I'd like you to discuss with the people around you, how many people are in hell? Go. You don't know. Well, come on. like, what are you doing? Come back there. Hitler, okay? Mussolini, Stalin. So we're at 3. Lenin, the number's growing to 4. Osama bin Laden is 5. Yes, mark that shirt in the back.
Pablo Escobar.
Got some mother-in-laws there. We got a 0. All right, thank you very much. So we have 0 on the spectrum. I mean, if God is mercy itself, then maybe there's 0. Dare we hope that all people go to heaven? You know? All right, let's do any other things people want. Yeah, the rich Lazarus. Please, sir, just a drop of water. Sorry, can't help you. Judas over here. Better of that, not for that man that would never been born. Let me do some shows, some a little showing of hands. How many people think less than half of the people that are born are in hell? So most people go to heaven. Less than 50% of the population goes to hell. Show of hands. Okay. Keep your hands up. Just for my own personal fun. Put your hands down if you lived through the 70s. So that's fun. Okay, show of hands. How many people think most people probably go to hell? I'm not raising any. This is an example of what that looks like. Okay. Great. Well, okay. Some preliminary comments. What we're gonna do tonight, we could be tempted to ask the question, well, how do you know that? How do you know that? How do you say that? How can anybody know that? The whole deal with Roman Catholicism is we have scriptural data, and we use our brains to process the data. So this is one of the coolest things that has happened in my priesthood so far. But I had this like very intellectual guy who called me up and he said, Father, I'm a lawyer, and I'm sick and tired of the Catholic faith. I don't believe it, I don't buy it, and I want to leave and join another faith I can really kind of sink my teeth into. But I was realizing I'm a professional and there are so many people that come to me with crazy ideas and I wish they would just leave it to the professionals. So I was thinking, maybe that's what I'm doing. So I should give a professional a chance to answer some of my questions. So what I would like to do is come in with my legal pad. I have a series of questions, and if you can give sufficient answers, great, I'll stay Catholic. And if you can't, well, then I'll just be on my way. I was like, great, no pressure. Come on in. And so he came in, and I really have to praise the guy for his intellectual humility. But he came in with his legal pad, and he said, okay, first things first, the whole conception of God, as far as Catholics believe, I kind of believe he's like the supreme teacher, he sets us in being, but then he kind of backs off and he watches us learn from our own mistakes, from our own lessons. He's not one of these gods that's constantly interfering with all of our daily doings. He leaves us to our own devices. With the one glaring exception of Jesus, who did intervene in human history. So that was to sort of kind of teach us how to live and how to love one another. But in an ordinary circumstance, God would never do that. He leaves us on our own. Great. Thank you. Thank you for the comment, for your thoughts. It's so important whenever we do through theology, to make sure that our theology is born from prayer. We have to make sure that we're praying through it. We're connecting with God, not in an intellectual level, but from the heart in prayer. And then step two, that it's born from the scriptural data, that it's right out of the Bible. Because if it's not born from those two things, then it's just a thought exercise, and we're kind of making it up on our own as we go. So let me ask you this. Which one of those two places did your theology of God as teacher come from? And he said, that's pretty good. And I'm going to put the rest of my questions away on my legal pad. Because they are all invented by himself. That's not what the church is doing. This is all born of prayer and sacred scripture. So we look at the scriptural data, and then we use our reasoning faculties. We don't have a God who wants to remain unknown. We have a God who's gone to great lengths to reveal himself to us and make himself known. That's the whole project of entering into relationship with humanity in the Old Testament and giving us Jesus in the New Testament and continuing his presence among us through the church, primarily through the sacraments. So he wants to be known. So we look at the scriptural data and we think it out with our brains. Sound good? Do you have any questions, comments, concerns, arguments, difficulties so far? Good. So this whole question, how many people are in hell, came from a lecture Cardinal Dulles gave back in 2002 at Fordham in New York. And the title of the lecture was The Population of Hell. One of the things I'm always talking about, the people in Huntley are probably sick of it. But Jesus is not a love guru. He's not the greatest leader of a hippie commune that's ever lived. And that's what we've turned him into. So I always say, if we went on the street and we polled people, Christians, non-Christians, Catholics, Baptists, Muslims, Hindus, whoever, if we ask them, what is the central teaching of Jesus Christ? What did he say more than anything else? Everybody would say, love one another. That's what Jesus said. He preached the message of acceptance, of love, of tolerance, of inclusivity. Totally wrong. Couldn't be more wrong. That's Godspell Jesus. I watched Godspell for the first time like a month ago. That is weird. Like the movie from the 70s? Whoa. But anyway, that's Godspell Jesus. Bible Jesus is a little bit different. The number one thing that came out of the mouth of our Lord during his tenure on this planet was, repent and believe in the gospel, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He always spoke with an urgency for conversion. Jesus' message wasn't a message of acceptance. On some level, he wasn't a very accepting guy because he'll never accept sin. He's always calling us to deeper repentance, deeper conversion. And so, in this lecture from Cardinal Dulles, we hear him say that Jesus spoke many times about hell. He describes the fate of the damned under a great variety of metaphors. Everlasting fire, outer darkness, tormenting thirst, a gnawing worm, weeping and gnashing of teeth. In the Gospel of John, which says comparatively little about hell, so the other Gospels have more to say about hell than John does. But in John we hear Jesus is quoted as saying, the hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear the Father's voice and come forth, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment. To be fair, there's a theological current that existed for, you know, so we're a 2,000-year-old religion, and from about 1970 to 1985, there was a little current that wanted to say, well, Jesus said those things, but figuratively. So when he's talking about the resurrection and judgment, he's just kind of teaching, being analogous, being transcendental, but he didn't really mean a resurrection of judgment. Okay, if you want to believe that Jesus was the kind of guy that wasted his words as he walked around the planet, that's, I suppose that's a legitimate option. My Jesus is a little bit more of a straight shooter. You know, meant what he said and said what he meant. Jesus says in Matthew 22:14, many are called, but few are chosen. And then, of course, in a few of the Gospels, we hear the little text about Judas. It would be better for that man if he had never been born. Loyola theological circles can kind of tell us, well, Jesus meant the psychological trauma that he would undergo, the stress, the personal emotions he would experience for having betrayed his master. That's up to you to decide. But Jesus says it would be better for that man if he had never been born. The book of Revelation teaches that there is a fiery pit where Satan and those who follow him will be tormented forever. It states at one point, as for the cowardly, the faithless, the polluted, as for murderers, fornicators, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their lot shall be the lake that burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Revelation 21:8. That's a great summer camp song, too. Revelation 21:8, liars burn in hell. And that's for you to use. Seminary is a weird place. In Galatians and Philippians, St. Paul is quoted as telling us, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. It's a very serious thing, your salvation. Don't just put your money on it, assume that since you have a baptismal certificate, no worries, we're all good to go. He says, work it out, keep it going with fear and trembling. In the Gospels, the devils proclaim that Jesus is the Holy One of God, but they're not saved by recognizing the fact. So if Scripture itself says belief in Jesus is obviously not enough to get to heaven, because all the demons do that. They're the first ones to pick it up that he is the Messiah. There has to be something else. The constant teaching of the Catholic Church supports the idea that there are two classes, the saved and the damned. That's our theological tradition. There's no arguing with that. Everyone, this is from Benedictus Deus, papal document of 1336, everyone who dies in a state of mortal sin goes immediately to suffer the eternal punishments of hell. And this belief has perdured without question in the Catholic Church to this day, and is repeated almost verbatim in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, numbers 1022 and 1035. So lest we think like, well, I suppose a pope in 1336 would say that, but that's not really what we believe today. Au contraire, it's right there in the current catechism that if you die in a state of mortal sin, you experience eternal punishment. Bummer. Jesus seems to limit salvation to baptized believers who refrain, this is St. Augustine, not Jesus, sorry. To limit salvation to baptized believers who refrain from serious sin or who after sinning repent and are reconciled with God. So, the virtual consensus among the fathers of the church and the Catholic theologians of later ages is that the majority of humankind goes to hell. The consensus among the fathers of the church, our foundational theologians, and then the theologians through the centuries, most of them, an overwhelming number, 98% believe that most of humankind goes to hell. I'm going to take a sip of water. Chew on that for a second. Call Monsignor Hermes and let him know confession lines will be a little longer. have to mention here that there's a minority opinion of the Greek fathers. So in our tradition, we have the Latins, you know, but there's a position among the Greek fathers like Clement of Alexandria, Origen, Gregory Nazianzus, and Gregory of Nyssa, that in the end, everybody will go to heaven. Origen was condemned for the idea because it was a little bit kooky. The idea is called apokastasis. That's the Greek word that in the end, everybody actually goes to heaven. But Origen believed in it in kind of a reincarnation sort of way. So if you lived your life, you weren't a very good person, an all-merciful God, he's going to let you get to heaven eventually. But out of justice, you have to have a do-over. You have to try again. So you get your mulligan, but then you got to take your next shot. So Origen would say, you just keep living your human existence over and over and over until you get it right. Church doesn't teach that, of course. So then we get to a little bit later theology, the 1950s and 60s. Hans Urs von Balthasar is a German theologian to come up with this idea. Dare we hope that all men be saved? That's the title of one of his books. So couldn't we believe that an all-merciful and all-loving God somehow would, in that last moment before we die or something, give us a particular grace or help us to be converted in those final moments? And plenty of people kind of like that and have agreed with him. Pius XII, in his encyclical of 1943, Mystici Corporis, said we should at least have good hopes for the eternal salvation of those who are in no way in the true Church of Christ. All right, so even Pius XII is kind of saying those people outside the church, maybe they don't all go to hell. We should have good hopes that we have a merciful God. And John Paul II, in Crossing the Threshold of Hope, says, can God, who is ultimate justice, tolerate terrible crimes and let them go unpunished? Final punishment would seem to be necessary to reestablish the moral equilibrium in the complex history of humanity. So the idea here is, do we have a merciful God? Sure we do. Do we have a just God? Absolutely. And this is a pretty important theological principle. I think we would like to think that our merciful God sometimes trumps our just God. But mercy and justice in divinity always go perfectly together. So he never sort of justly acts to the detriment of his mercy. His justice is always merciful, and his mercy is always just. So John Paul II is kind of saying, if you murder 6 million people and you're not very repentant, you get a free pass after you die. Does that kind of seem like what a just God would do? Do you have any thoughts or comments so far? Yes. Yeah, I've heard that. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. I don't know the origin of that. Well, we got the narrow gate. Jesus talks about the narrow gate. I was just talking to an Italian lady. You know, like Italian, like just got off the boat Italian. Really don't read boats anymore. But she took care of her uncle, who was an ailing Scalabrini priest. And she got to take care of him while he had this terrible cancer for like 2 years. And I guess he said to her one day, you know, Renata, it is very easy to be a Catholic. It's very difficult to be a good Catholic. Right? I think that's kind of the idea with the narrow gate thing with Jesus, you know. Lots of people can get baptismal certificates. It's a lot harder to really put Jesus on the throne and give your life over to him. A good thief who repented. Well, you know, I guess the question is how many people ask for God's mercy? So I think everybody in this room would say, as soon as you ask for it, as soon as you desire it, boom, it's granted. as soon as we're repentant, absolutely 100%, no matter what the sin is. But then I guess implicitly in the question, how many people are in hell, is how many people ask for that mercy, or how many people live their life going it alone. Yes?
Hitler was Catholic.
Hitler was Catholic.
So, he was very aware of beliefs. Theoretically, he could have repented at the end. They say he committed suicide, but nobody seems to know absolutely positively.
Right.
So, theoretically, mm-hmm. he would like to think that that would be just, but
well, yeah, Hitler could certainly go to heaven. If he repented before he died, of course, he could go to heaven. Mentally ill? Mental illness does not absolve us from sin, but it does reduce moral culpability. So it makes our judgment less severe, depending on the degree of our mental illness. Way in the back.
This idea of repentance brings to mind when I was at another church.
Yes.
Another church. One of our priests at his homily said, one of my instructors in seminary told me, if you ever get to heaven yourself, don't be surprised if you find Hitler and Stalin there. And at first he couldn't believe it, but then he thought, well, they were willing, even at the last minute, to beg for mercy and to be truly sorry for their sins. Sure, they could do. They could even grant heaven. Even Judas, if he had bothered to ask for mercy and forgiveness, it would have been readily granted.
Right. I hope I'm not being unclear on this. Anybody, no matter how heinous the sin, who begs God's mercy, can go to heaven. Absolutely, without qualification.
Don't they say we won't help and choose
them? All right, thanks for bringing that up. She said, don't they say people in hell choose it? That's kind of a big point of our talk tonight. We have a God who's all about logical consequences. So it even extends into the realm of God's punishments. So the Bible tells us that God punishes, but God's punishment is a logical consequence. So stay out drinking every night. Don't come home to your family. Gamble your money away. There will be family problems. That's a natural consequence, which is a punishment that God, you know, in his own way, has built into our human system, our human condition. So sin causes division. Sin causes problems. If we sin, we'll experience punishment. But the cancer we get is not because we offended God. You know, that's not the type of direct punishment. But there is a logical consequence that happens. That's God's punishment. So we have a God who loves us very much, who has given us free will, which is really our stamp of his image and likeness. That's what makes us so like him. And when we choose, he gives us the result of our choice. So we have time. I'm going to be talking for a while, so you can put your hands down and we'll get it in a second.
Mama.
We have this God who deals with us in time and in eternity. And eternity is not forever and ever 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 and ever. A lot of times we think that, and sometimes we have a cup of coffee with a friend, and we might even say something to the effect of, okay, I know this sounds terrible, but I don't even know if I'm going to like heaven, because it's just, I heard it's like staring at the face of God forever. That sounds so boring. But eternity is not forever and ever. Eternity is timelessness. It's the absence of time. There is no succession from now to then. It's the eternal moment. It's the eternal present. So whatever we want in time, God grants to us in eternity. So if we live our whole life focused inwardly on ourselves, on our own desires, there will be logical punishments in life. That's not a good way to live. I know our Lord is saying, give yourself, give to others, open up, get outside of yourself, live for God, make Him the Lord of your life, and serve your brothers and sisters. And that's true happiness. That's true peace. That's where you'll experience the consolation of the Holy Spirit. And those things will happen in eternity, in timelessness. You choose God in your life through a consistent series of life choices. That's what you'll get in eternity. You'll get God, which is hope and mercy and blessedness and joy and mutual love and all those sorts of things. In life, if you shackle yourself to your own smallness, if you turn inward and look to yourself, that's exactly what you'll get in eternity. He'll grant you the desires of your heart. And you are not hope and peace and joy and mercy and kindness and justice. So hell is not so much the devil kind of poking you with a pitchfork forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Heaven is the result of choosing yourself over and against all those wonderful things that God is. So we get exactly what we ask for. Yeah, we're going to get to purgatory when we're done talking about hell. No, it's great. I love your anticipation. Yes, sir. Chosen, or the Bible says, it's not you that chose me, it's I that chose you. This is kind of a predestination issue.
Yeah.
You know. Catholics actually believe in predestination. What? We don't believe in double predestination. Okay, so it's our destiny to go to heaven. That's why we've been brought into existence. God wants all of us to go to heaven. And He chose us. All of us. Chose us to get to heaven. We didn't get this deal because we invented it. That's what that means. God, out of His total gratuitous goodness, freely gave us a relationship with Himself so that we might go to heaven, so long as we cooperate with Him. And He's given everybody sufficient grace to do that. Some of us choose to go along with the grace, and some of us don't. That's the mysterium iniquitatis. That's the crazy thing. So, all right, so please don't raise your hands. But a lot of us in this room have had a prayer experience where we like hand ourselves over to the Lord in a time of prayer. And it's been wonderful. And we've done it for like a consistent period of time, like 6 months. And that 6 months was like the best 6 months of our lives. We felt close to God. We felt happy. We felt strength when we had to endure hardship. And we were like spiritually rocking. And we know prayer makes us feel better. Maybe not in like in a period of 6 months, but in like a single day. We know that prayer just kind of gets us through the day better. And we love how we feel after we pray. But I don't want to pray today. You know, there's like this stumbling block or something. That's the mystery of sin. Even though we know that is what's best for us, we just rather not do it. And so, why do some people accept the grace? Why do others not? If you ever get the answer to that question, let us know. We'll have you give the talk. You know, that's the age-old question, the mystery of sin. Why does it happen that way? But it does happen that way. So Catholics believe in this type of predestination. Double predestination is what Calvinists kind of believe in, that God has created some people to go to heaven, and He's created some people to go to hell. And the elect, the chosen, are invisible. We'll never know which ones are which. But you kind of live your life as best you can, and hopefully you're a member of the elect and the chosen. Which I always say has got to make like Baptist potlucks very interesting. You know? you're walking with your 3D salad, kind of eyeing everybody up. I wonder if you're a member of the show. Okay, I'm going to keep talking. So Cardinal Bellis, the Cardinal of the Church, reminds us that eternal damnation remains a possibility, but we're not granted without special divine revelation the knowledge of whether or which human beings are effectively involved in it. So, do Catholics believe in hell? Yes, we have to. Hell exists. It is a serious possibility. Let's not listen to Godspell Jesus. Let's listen to the Bible, to the data of the New Testament that's on the printed page, that hell is serious, it's real, it could happen. How many people are in hell? Well, we have no way of knowing that. Maybe there are zero people in hell. That could actually be the case. The thought of heaven, the thought of hell, and even less the improper use of biblical images, must not create anxiety or despair. But it's a necessary and healthy reminder of freedom within the proclamation that the risen Jesus has conquered Satan. So we don't do the whole hell thing to be spooky, to be scary. I know it's a pretty common experience among some of our more seasoned Catholics, that you had some nuns in grade school or whatever that really just beat the idea of hell into you. That's not our mission here at all. But we don't want the pendulum to swing the other way either and kind of skip around and throw daisies everywhere and say, hell, that's what your grandparents believed in. That's not a real thing. No, you know, it came forth from the mouth of Jesus quite a few times. And so we want to have that, just like anything, we want to have that healthy balance in between the two extremes. The earlier pessimism, says Cardinal Dulles, was based on the unwarranted assumption that explicit Christian faith is absolutely necessary for salvation. So, earlier theologians are thinking that you need to go through a Roman Catholic baptismal ceremony, have the water sprinkled on your head by a priest or a deacon to make it into heaven. Later theology sort of says, well, Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me. Unless you're born of water and the Holy Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. Okay, there's got to be something to that. But remember that thing you learned about the different forms of baptism? The baptism of blood, the baptism of desire. Those are sort of legitimate options. So our Lord chooses to work through the sacraments, but he's never limited by them. So baptism is necessary, but explicit Catholic faith is not necessary for salvation. So that opens up the possibility of a lot more people going to heaven, right? Any questions on any of that? That usually gets a few questions. No? Yeah. Yeah, selling your soul to the devil?
Yeah.
I don't think you can actually do that because your soul isn't yours. Now, you can invite the devil to work on you in a much greater way by doing that, but you never sort of like fully hand over the deed. That would be sort of the green light to mess with me in my life or something, but it's not his. Yeah, I would guess that the way a lot of celebrities live their lives welcomes the devil. All right, I just want to clarify this point. It's really, really, really important to be baptized because St. Thomas Aquinas teaches us that baptism provides what's necessary for salvation, and relatedness to baptism provides what's potential for salvation. So let's put that another way. Do baptized people go to heaven? Yes. Can unbaptized people go to heaven? Yes. Do unbaptized people go to heaven? Can't say that one. You can't say that one. All you can say is they can. It's potentially possible, given the scriptural data. That's why baptism is so necessary. We want to get our babies baptized right away. We want to go set the world on fire. Jesus tells us you got to get baptized. So would a merciful God judge people in such a way that they couldn't attain salvation without baptism? You know, that's up to him. But all we can tell you is he told us all to get baptized. So as long as I'm walking around this planet, as long as I'm in McHenry County, because the Master told me so, I'm going to try to get as many people baptized as possible. The rest is up to him. We never want to make it sort of a superfluous idea. There were just too many Jesuits in the 1600s that had their fingers gnawed off by native peoples where they were trying to spread the gospel to believe that it really doesn't matter whether you're baptized or not. The missionary activity of the church never would have taken place without the deep conviction that we have to bring as many people to the font of baptism as possible. So it's not a superfluous concept. It's very, very important. But Pius XII reminds us it is possible. And so we always have hope and confidence in God's mercy, but we never want to be lazy about it. Cool? Yeah. Anybody can baptize as long as they use water, say the Trinitarian words, and intend to do what the church does. So even an atheist can baptize as long as they intend to do what the church does. Yeah, you don't even have to be a Catholic or anything. Yes? We very much believe that grace builds on nature. So that's the church on the books kind of says, don't go baptizing grandchildren in the sink because they're not. Somebody has to make a promise that they're going to be raised in the practice of the faith. The idea being that grace builds on nature. So this is my example for grace builds on nature. It takes 8 years to go through the seminary. So let's say you go through your 8 years of schooling as a huge jerk. You're just selfish, big jerk, mean to everybody around you. And it becomes your ordination day, and you kneel down in front of the bishop. He places his hands on your head, and then he extends his arms and says the prayer invoking the Holy Spirit, which transformed your soul into that of a priest. You will rise as a priest of the Most High God, who's a jerk, right? Grace builds on nature. He doesn't destroy our nature with his grace. And the same would be true with baptism. So it's not a magic trick. It's not a special ritual. You know, if we sprinkle the water on the baby's head, it's not going to give that baby faith or make something magical happen. We have to consistently bring the child up in the practice of the faith. And if that's not going to take place, then the church says, let's hold off on baptism until a little bit later. There is that out there. Some priests will tell you, do it in the light of day. We're children of the light. Jesus is the light of the world. Let's not have sneaky, backhanded practices, you know. And just trust that God is very merciful. Other priests will tell you, put the pit in the sink of baptizing. So, you know, that would be good. Pope Benedict XVI went on retreat up in the north of Italy, and he met with a bunch of priests, and some of the priests asked him that question. And he said, you know, when I was a young priest, I followed the rules. I was all about, you know, making sure I did everything according to the code of canon law. But as I got a little bit older and a little more life experience, I saw some wisdom in being a lot freer with the sacraments also, so that was his answer. So if you're young, don't baptize the baby in the sink. If you're older, do it. Grandchildren, I'm a baptized Methodist. Well, according to the Catholic Church, your grandchildren are definitely baptized. But there's a lot more in between this and that that's going to determine whether or not they go to heaven. You know what I mean? If we believe zero people are in hell, that's one thing. But if we believe maybe the number is a little bit higher than zero, then a lot of other factors come into play in how many people are in heaven, how many people are in hell. So we might not want to say everybody who's baptized validly or whatever goes to heaven. It's at least conceivable that someone receives baptism and consistently chooses themselves over God and doesn't make it to heaven, right? Hey, we're turning into a little heavy on the hell side of things, so we gotta... So Cardinal Dulles says, it's a moot point. There's no way we can know how many people are in hell. He really baited us on that one. But he does say, we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. And if we persevere in that love, nothing whatever can separate us from Christ. I happen to think, this is just kind of personally speaking, I happen to think that hell is a very distinct possibility. And I would never want to, I mean, heck, I drove all the way to Crystal Lake to talk about it tonight. So it's obviously something that needs to be taught. We need to be educated in this forum about it. This is perfectly the proper forum to talk about hell as the people of God. But I also believe that if you give a piece of your heart to our Lord, we have a God who's going to scale any barrier, you know, to figure out how to give us his mercy. And I always like to think of this story with St. John Vianney. There was a widow who came to him whose husband was really, you know, speaking of jerks, he was quite a jerk, a very, very bad guy, and he did not go to church or practice the faith or anything, and she was so worried that he was being tormented in hell and knew that Father Vianney got a lot of visions and things. So she went to him and said, I need to know, is my husband in hell? And he said, no, he actually got to go to heaven. And she said, why? How did that happen? Remember a couple of years ago when you wanted to put that image of the Sacred Heart in your bedroom? I remember. You asked your husband for permission and he said, sure, you can hang it in the bedroom. I do. That act of faith and love on his part was enough that God could come in and flood him with his mercy and he was able to go to heaven. So hell is a distinct possibility, but it's not something to keep before our eyes, because we have a God who's figuring out every way imaginable to get us into the pearly gates. Okay? Sweet. A little happier, let's talk about purgatory. Purgatory did not go away with the Second Vatican Council. Matter of fact, if you read the documents of the Second Vatican Council, they explicitly mention purgatory in those documents. So it's been sort of the consistent teaching of the Catholic Church. Here's our first problem with purgatory. Many of our separated brethren, our non-Catholic brothers and sisters in the Christian faith, will say, purgatory, where is that in the Bible? Okay? First things first. If the church says there's purgatory, there's purgatory. Okay. That's every question we ask as Catholics really goes back to what is the church? Or maybe even better, who is the church? If the church is a medieval institution founded by Italian men with bejeweled hats to propagate a system of feudal land ownership to get money and taxes and sell more fish on Fridays. If that's what the Catholic Church is, and they say there's a purgatory and you can get indulgences and blah, 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 well then, that's the most ridiculous thing ever, and nobody should believe in purgatory. But if, as Ephesians 5 tells us, that Christ desired the church and shed his blood, was crucified to make her holy, preserving her from every spot, stain, or wrinkle, well then that's a different ballgame. If the church is the assembly of believers specifically willed by Christ, well then we can put a lot more stock in what she says. So the question is not, is there purgatory, isn't there purgatory? The real question is, what is the church? And if the church is what we say it is, let's start talking about purgatory. Then, beyond that, it actually is in the Bible. There are plenty of references to purgatory in the Bible. In 2 Maccabees, we have Judas Maccabeus making atonement for the dead, that they might be delivered from sin. Jesus talks about not being released from the fiery flames until you've paid the last penny. There's definitely this concept of atoning for some debt after death, right out of the mouth of our Savior. If we're talking about the word purgatory, no, you're right, that's not in the Bible. You could go cover to cover and you won't find the word purgatory. But you won't find the word Trinity either. But there's not a Christian around who's going to say, I don't believe in the Trinity, because the word Trinity is not in the Bible. Remember the very first thing I said tonight? We use the scriptural data, and we use our reasoning faculties to arrive at some understanding of what's in there. That's exactly what we've done with purgatory. I suppose they could have changed the name or come up with a different name at some point, but the concept of atoning for sin after death is very, very scriptural. And Christians have believed it from day one. The Bible says two things. Well, it says a lot of things, but two things I want to talk about right now. The first thing it says is, all have sinned and are deprived of the glory of God. He who says he is without sin is a fool. So, sometimes in Huntley, I like to stand, on nice days, I like to stand out in front of the church and kind of be a nerd. And I'll say like different things as people are coming in. And one day I say, I'm like, come on inside. We're giving out Eucharist. Sinners welcome. And people usually, you know, chuckle a little bit. And this one day, one lady came up and was like, what about those of us that aren't sinners? And I said, that's the great news. There aren't any. And she came up to me like privately and was like, you know, you really make me feel bad. She manifested a belief that plenty of people have. I'm a pretty good person, ergo, I don't sin. This is not a young priest coming right out of the seminary, gung-ho ideology, you know. Give him a few years and he'll start believing that people don't actually sin. You don't have to take my word for it. It's right there in the Bible. All have sinned and are deprived of the glory of God. And he who says he does not sin is a fool. That's in the first letter of St. John. What we've done is kind of make being a sinner and being a good person mutually exclusive, which is something we never want to do. So at the risk of sounding arrogant, I consider myself a fairly decent guy. I didn't steal any groceries from an old lady today, nothing, you know, like. But at the same time, I'm pretty good at sinning. I mean, I can think up some pretty good ways, pretty much on a daily basis, to sin. But that doesn't mean I'm a bad dude. It means I sin all the time, and I'm so in need of God's mercy. So given that fact, G.K. Chesterton tells us, we're all in the same boat, and we're all seasick. We all sin. The Bible also says in the book of Revelation, nothing unclean shall enter into heaven. So if we're all sinners, we're all unclean, and the Bible says nothing can enter into heaven, Well, that's a huge bummer. But purgatory is our gift that God has given us. Purgatory is not a downer, as we kind of talked. Purgatory is a wonderful thing. It's a deal we've been given so that uncleanliness can be cleaned and purified so that we can get into heaven. The common misconception, especially for American Catholics of the last 60 years, is that purgatory is a jail sentence. Well, if you gossiped 15 times, you're going to spend 65 days in purgatory. That is not how purgatory works. You had, raise your hand if you had a prayer book back in the day that said, the Hail Mary, a 365 days indulgence. Okay. What we all believe, and by we I mean you, back in the day, what we all believed back in the day was that you said the Hail Mary prayer, or whatever the prescribed prayer of that prayer book was, you got out of purgatory for 365 days. That's not what it meant. In the early church, penances were public. So you had, you committed this sin, you had to kneel on the fourth step outside the church for 365 days. When that was done, you could go back in and worship with the Eucharistic assembly. That's the way things happened in the third century, let's say. But when the Irish, came around and privatized confession, they said, well, we can't be doing public penances anymore, so they transferred those things. So rather than kneel on the step for 365 days, say this prayer, and that'll take care of your time on the step. It had nothing to do with your time in purgatory. So what purgatory actually is the realization of what our sins have done. It's kind of like when families come in to meet with me and to plan for family funerals, a lot of times one of the children will say, I never really knew what my dad did for me until I became a dad myself. Okay? So purgatory is that state where we never really knew what our sin did until we saw sin as God sees it. In purgatory, we're going to understand sin as God understands it. And that's going to stink. It's going to be very embarrassing. It's also going to be very purifying. Because once we get it, we will never want to do it again. Now, could there be time in purgatory? Well, yes, there could be. Not exactly like the time we experience now, since There has to be some type of time, because we go from being unclean to being clean, right? So change necessitates some conception of time. But does it have to be exactly the way we have it now? Who knows? But we go from being unclean to clean. And if we're trying to understand things as God understands them, could that take longer for some people than it does for others? Yeah, there's different learning curves for everybody. So that kind of plays into it as well. Maybe some of us will be in there a very brief period of time because we'll get it, and others of us will be in there a much longer time because we're just not learning the lesson. So when I gave this talk at the parish in Huntley, about this time, one lady raised her hand and said, Father, you're making it sound like pretty much everybody goes to purgatory. I hope you know that. And I was like, I do. So that's kind of we're all going to be in need of that purification. Now, the concept of praying for the dead is less like commuting someone's jail sentence. So I had 10 masses offered, and now they're going to get 3 years off of their time in purgatory. That's not necessarily the way to look at it. I like to think of the prayers for the dead in purgatory like love letters in boot camp. Okay, so you're in boot camp, you're losing your strength, you're isolated, you're on your own, you don't really have any buddies there, and then mail call, you get a letter from a loved one, and you read it, and you get this new strength, this new courage, this new hope to fight, to carry on, that helps you to persevere through this challenge. Okay. And maybe that even speeds up the process a little bit, depending on how you react Those are what our prayers for the dead are like. So they are absolutely essential. We should be praying for all our loved ones. But I don't think it's the healthiest way to think of it as like commuting jail time or getting the sentence shaved off. Any questions? Blessed Virgin Mary said this one 18-year-old who died is going to be in purgatory till the end of time. Yeah. If that's true, then I would believe it's true. Yeah, I mean, I suppose it could take a longer time. I mean, that's what I'm trying to say is it could take longer for some people than others. It's going to depend on a lot of circumstances. But all the saints and mystics have been very clear in encouraging us to pray for our loved ones. I think, you know, in the seminary at least, they talk about that's one of the great sins of our times, is when you get to a funeral and they say, isn't it great so-and-so is in heaven? He's an angel now. Those are two theological errors, huge theological errors. First of all, we're depriving that person of our prayers. And then second of all, we're changing their species after death. People that see visions of angels or dead relatives or something before they die, don't we believe they go right to heaven? Not necessarily. I mean, it's a much more logical thing to believe they go to purgatory for some period of time, like most people. I have we'll talk about doormen for a second. But when I pray for my family members, I can't imagine anybody holier and sweeter and kinder and more innocent and wonderful than this great aunt I had, who we called her Dorme. But I still pray for Dorme, you know, as a suffering soul, because this is the way I kind of think about it. Let's say Dorme is in purgatory. Man, I'm really helping Dorme out. And let's say Dorme is in heaven. I don't think God is up there laughing at me, like, you fool. Dorme is in heaven and you're just wasting your prayers. So no matter how good, how wonderful somebody is, I think they're still aided by our prayers, you know, as they go through boot camp. And if they're not, then maybe those prayers get transferred to some other soul that could really, really use them or something. But that's just, I think it's a best practice never to assume. True or false? If you go to purgatory, you are guaranteed heaven. True. Purgatory is not a test, like depending on how you do this. We're in the test now. So purgatory is the purification process to get us ready for heaven. And here's another thing that the mystics tell us. Everybody that's there in purgatory wants to be there. Some of the souls that have kind of revealed mystical visions to saints on earth have said that they were given the option, you can be done now if you just want to go to heaven. And the souls in purgatory say, no, thank you. I don't want to stand before God with any stain. I want to go through the purification. They very much want to be there because there's hope there, and they can get a glimpse of that blessedness. Think of how excited we are to see God now. We get closer to this intermediate state. We want to do it right. We want to do it well. Yes, that's. Well, there's definitely some type of suffering on earth, but does it count for your suffering? Yeah, I don't want to think of it that way. Like, does it count? Do you get less time suffering in purgatory if you do more suffering here? Well, of course you can be sanctified here. That's what we're doing.
I mean, like, let's say...
Can you die and go straight to heaven? What do you think?
Yes.
Why? Okay, so we don't think Mother Teresa went to purgatory. I think she did. The Bible tells us all have sinned and are deprived of the glory of God. And he who says he doesn't sin is a fool. Our Mother Teresa's sin is way different than ours, at least mine. I hope so. But, you know, whatever her purification was like, was it swift? That would be a logical thing to believe. But to think that a creature died with no sin whatsoever, no attachment to sin, no little vanities or prideful thoughts or judgments or lazinesses or whatever it might be, that doesn't really seem to be the human being. How about an infant? Could they go straight to heaven? Small children. Well, I'm not. That we have is twofold. You know, there's that the human thing that we just have, right? You know, it's our drive down Randall Road, and you can see the human condition at its worst. There's something in us that makes us choose ourselves that even infants have. St. Augustine is the meanest who's ever talked about it, but he said, babies cry, they're just being selfish. They're just thinking of it. They're just manifesting their own sinfulness. You know, me, so that's a little extreme to state it that way, but the Randall rootedness is, they have it, you know, they have the concupiscence. What they don't have is all the actual sins being committed. So, is it conceivable that an infant who was baptized or something would go straight to heaven? Yeah, that's conceivable. But would it be conceivable that there's also some type of burning off the Randall Roadedness in this purgative process that would be necessary for them as well? I think that would also, you know, we have to keep that in mind. Here's the other thing. Our souls, you know, we do experience things and shape our souls as we live. But when that infant soul gets to heaven and is infused with the full knowledge of existence, it's not as if God's punishing the little baby in purgatory. You know? I mean, it's not necessarily an infant, little, precious little baby soul that's so cute and adorable and God's just a big, meanie God. You know, it would receive a much greater fullness of understanding in that moment as well. Yes, Barbara? You had no recognition of God?
Daddy.
Maybe. The anonymous Christian? Person in Papua New Guinea who never heard about God, wouldn't they go straight to heaven? Is that your question? The point I'm trying to make is we all have that Randall Road thing, We're all, you know, we all look out for number one. Sometimes we gossip and we talk about the people that we love most in our lives, or sometimes the people that we just couldn't live without are the people we speak the worst to. Or, you know, sometimes nuns waste paper. You know? and that's their sin or whatever. But whoever we are and whatever our vocation in life, there's ways to move forward in holiness. There's ways we're falling short because we just have that tendency to do so. So my point is, I think it's very logically conceivable that just about everybody has to pass through this purgative process. But the good news is, first of all, it's a gift, and second of all, we want to be there. You know, nobody's saying, "Aw, shucks." Yeah. The thing I'm trying to say is we'll see sin as God sees sin. That's what will make it ultimately so painful. But you know, the moral of the story is it's not going to be all sunshine and lollipops in purgatory, but it is a good thing, and we'll realize that. We all want the pill now. You know, on this earth, we want the pill. We want it to be the easiest, the fastest, the smoothest, without suffering. That's another part of that Randall rotedness. When we're in purgatory and being purified, that's one of those things we're going to understand. Is that we don't want the pill, the easy answer. We want to do it right. And we want to be legitimately pure and be holy before we enter God's presence. Yep, there's different levels of suffering in purgatory. There's definitely suffering there. We suffer the realization of our sins. And depending on the degree of the sin that we committed would be the greater the suffering. Mm-hmm. If you waste paper, you'll probably suffer less than if you... gossip about a priest or something. Yes. What about miscarried babies? How about what about unbaptized babies? Okay. This is a very delicate point. Unbaptized babies, unbaptized anybody, can they go to heaven?
Yes.
Absolutely. Do they go to heaven? We don't have the authority on this planet to say unequivocally, absolutely, no question, because of what's in the New Testament out of the mouth of our Savior. But what's in our catechism, and what's in the teaching of the Vatican's International Theological Commission is to say that given everything we know, it would seem totally contrary to the nature of our good God that he would send unbaptized babies to hell. It would seem totally crazy. They don't have to be baptized. Do our guardian angels go to purgatory with us? I don't believe so. I believe when we die, our guardian angels get reassigned. That's not a joke, I'm serious. I'm sorry? Yes. Is this the apostolic pardon question?
Your brother's wife.
there's this thing called the apostolic pardon, right? So you're dying, you get anointed, that forgives all your sins, and the priest comes to your bedside, and he says, I'm not doing this right now. By the authority which the apostolic see has given me, I grant you a full pardon and the remission of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's it. That's your sins are forgiven, and the punishments due your sins are forgiven in that moment. So that's the fullness of everything that Christ has entrusted to the church to be given to a dying person. So, all your sins, all the punishments due your sins are forgiven in that moment. That's a very powerful prayer. It's a very wonderful thing to be entrusted to priests. I still can't believe God did that, but he did do it, which is great. But any of those attachments or that random-rootedness that can sort of be rooted out, you know, so the acts that we committed on random-road, the punishment is forgiven those, but the core of us that would just do it again tomorrow if we lived a little longer, that's still there. That needs to be purified in some way. So I'm just not a huge fan of this dude didn't go to church for a long time. He was kind of bad to his family, but Father did show up and wave his hand over him, and now he goes boom, straight to heaven. And I don't mean to negate the beauty of the priesthood or the power of the sacraments, or, you know, I don't mean that for a second, but it's not magic either, you know, so there's some purification that might still have to take place, but we don't want to think of it as punishment in jail sentence terms anyway. It's purification that has to take place after death. No? You don't like that?
I don't
have a
problem with it.
Yeah.
But it's beyond my comprehension.
Okay.
The only thing I can say is I got to put my faith in God.
Yes.
He knows what he's doing because he gave the priest that power.
Mm-hmm.
He gave us something to hold on to for our love on God.
Yes. That's very important. I'll probably have like 4 or 5 priests come to my deathbed, each of them doing the apostolic pardon. I think it's hugely important, and it's a gift that Christ has entrusted to us through the church. And so, you know, everybody in this room, be anointed. Have your family members anointed. Ask for the apostolic pardon. Make sure those things happen. But please also realize that it's not sort of a free pass that negates everything about the way we lived our lives either. You know, they have to go hand in hand. It has to be integrity of heart, integrity of behavior, and the faith in the church's sacraments as well. Yes, Mom?
I need to answer your question.
Never mind. Yes?
As a priest, could you grant an apostolic pardon to yourself?
Only with a mirror.
Great question.
This is a good question.
No, you can't. Thank you for the question. You can't hear our own confessions either. What about a drug overdose victim? You know, I think most people who are on their way to heaven pass through purgatory. I hope I'm hitting that point home tonight. But a drug overdose does not damn you to hell. I remember when I was in college, my theology 101 teacher at Marquette University, was the Reverend Dr. Cheryl Peterson. She was an evangelical Synod Lutheran. And she was teaching us that the Catholic Church teaches currently that the only sin that's unforgivable is suicide. And so I was like, Reverend, I don't know what to say. That's not true. Healthy people don't kill themselves, you know. So all those sorts of mental illnesses that factor in, the church has a lot of compassion and a lot of trepidation in the sense that we don't totally understand all those things. But those sorts of medical, mental, emotional, psychological issues, they don't damn you to hell by any stretch of the imagination. On the same token, there still could be some moral culpability that remains. You know, so there might be some legitimate suffering that has to go on after death because of those actions. So the church kind of teaches there's a cloudiness in judgment, but maybe you're still able to kind of make judgments too, you know, so that's important to remember. Yes? What happens if a person dies right before the priest gets to them for last rites? A couple things. The sacraments are for the living. So, you know, if you're here in your hospital room with somebody who died 2 hours ago, and then you call the priest, and the priest gets there about 2.5 hours, you know, don't bully the priest into an anointing, because the sacraments really are for the living. That's the way it happens. There's certainly, you know, the blessing of the body, there's prayers to be said. In the same way, though, they taught us that, and maybe some of you are more medical people than I am, but there's brain activity for about 22 minutes after somebody's kind of declared that there's no heartbeat or whatever, they stop breathing. For about 22 minutes, there's brain activity. So I would always, you know, anoint in those few moments after death. But significantly after death, that's not the moment for the anointing of the sick. The crazy thing is, if somebody is sick, you give them the anointing. If somebody is dying, you don't start with that sacrament. That's not the first thing that should be administered. The first thing you should do is hear their confession. You know, absolve them of their sins if that is possible. I mean, if it's going down fast and the medical staff is pretty sure this person will die, you hear their confession, you give them the Holy Eucharist, you give them the apostolic pardon, then if there's time and they're still living, then you anoint them. But the anointing of the sick really is for sickness, not for death. Yeah. Private revelations of sort of life after death stuff, or what the Blessed Mother can do to people suffering around their deathbed. Just like any private revelation, if it increases your faith, you really ought to go full speed ahead with it. And if it takes your faith away or becomes a stumbling block for you, we better avoid it at all costs. Does their soul leave their body? We are not one of the religions that believes the soul lingers for a very long time. So a few minutes, 20 minutes, a couple of days, no, not a couple of days. But the soul could linger for a little bit and then kind of make its way up to heaven or purgatory. Okay, everybody. That was Mikey. Yeah, if the soul lingers, what does that look like? I would assume it'd be different for different people. So it could be an unconscious kind of thing, like while you're sleeping, your soul is there, you don't really know. But it could also be one of those things where you're like in the room looking at the medical staff work on you, but that could be a possibility too. It would be a case by case sort of thing. The final judgment. Nobody cheered. At the end of time, on the last day, Jesus will come back. This is not according to the book of Revelation. Just a real quick sidebar. The book of Revelation is a historical document. It's not a roadmap for the future. So everything that happened in the book of Revelation happened in the past. Those were sort of figurative images that discussed history. It's not something like we're waiting for. So we hear a lot of thunder crash and we're kind of looking for the chariots or whatever. It might not shake out exactly that way. However it happens, our Lord will come back and we will be reunited with our bodies. Our souls and our bodies will come back together. Some of us are like, yes. Other of us are like, oh, man. Eternity with this thing. The resurrection and the last judgment will be sort of when our Lord judges everybody that's on earth at the same time. Nobody who's dead gets rejudged. So it's not like you made the callback list for heaven, but we still have to see if you're going to make the final cut. That's not really how it works. If you're in heaven, you're good to go, you're in heaven. And if you're not, you're not. But even those souls in hell will be reunited with their bodies. Since we are not the religion that's imprisoned by the flesh trying to escape our entire existence, Jesus is telling us that this is the point of it. I took out your body because this is how I want you to exist forever, as a soul and a body together. So the judgment happens. Our bodies are glorified. So remember when we had those Emmaus readings and the apostles see Jesus and they can't really tell it's him because his body's been glorified? There's something that will be different and new and transformed and glorified about our bodies. We don't exactly know what they'll look like. Origen, an early church theologian, used geometry to say that since the sphere was the perfect shape, that glorified bodies will be orbs. They'll be spherical. So you're looking at heaven. Let's hear some folks. The final judgment is not about sort of like fear and torment and the word judgment, but the final judgment is when all falsehood and duplicity and deceit passes away. So actually, like our sins will come to light. So you know that thought we have sometimes that's like, I'm going to confession in a week anyway, so I'll squeeze this one in a couple more times. Since I gotta confess it anyhow. Like, all those things come to light in the final judgment. So, if for no other reason than not shaming yourself at the end of time, we want to avoid sin. Of course, we want to do it out of perfect love, but whatever works. So, sort of falsehood, duplicity passes away, and everything comes to light. Not so that we can be stuck in that shame or whatever, but so that truth and goodness and justice can reign. Because isn't it conceivable that there are believers out there that look like believers, but then behind the scenes have these like totally fake, phony lives? That's not a possibility anymore after the final judgment. All that stuff comes to light, and so we get to live in the freedom of the children of God quite physically on the new earth, the new heaven that's, you know, we hear so much about in the book of the prophet Isaiah. You know, lambs will lie down with lions and snakes will play with babies.
Will everybody be
out of purgatory? Purgatory is done. Purgatory is like a temporary thing. So when Jesus comes back and the final judgment happens, no more purgatory. It's either heaven or hell. What happens if you don't have a body? Yeah, or you're cremated, or eaten by sharks. Yeah, God will put, if you don't have like a body, God will put it back together somehow. Yeah. I don't know the physics of it all, and I can't explain the process, but it'll. Thanks. You know, Cardinal Newman, who's Blessed John Henry Newman now, was buried in like a damp, musty, weird Birmingham oratory in England. And you know, they always have to examine saints' bodies and the cause for the canonization process. So when they opened his coffin up, nothing. He had like totally, whatever, the cemetery. So whatever's gonna happen to him, all. But we'll all find out at the time, so anyway. Then finally, we get to heaven. Just like with hell, eternity is the result of the series of our choices we made during life. And that's exactly what heaven is. If you chose God in your life, that's what you'll get in eternity. So, there's a moral current in the church that's wrong called the fundamental option. We do not believe this as Catholics, that like I've made my fundamental choice. Fundamentally, I want to love God and follow God, but I just fall down like a ton of times and tolerate certain sins in my life. We don't believe that. We believe that our fundamental option is manifested through consistent life choices. You know, am I consistently choosing God in my life? We can fall down hundreds of thousands of times, but as long as we get up and we strive for holiness again and choose mercy and joy and love and peace and hope and justice and kindness, and if we want to be poetic, it's like birthdays and Christmas and laughing and Portillo's for eternity. So our eternal state is the result of our temporal choices, the choices we made in time. And so heaven's not a place in the universe as much a condition in the next life. Where God's will is done without any resistance. John, you could have a cookie, or you could have a stalk of celery. Lord, I'll have the celery. That's heaven. There's still free will in heaven. We don't become robots, but we become like the Blessed Virgin Mary. We want to choose the good thing. So we're on Randall Road. You could cut this car off and go much faster. I don't even want to do that. There's just complete happiness in heaven. Are there levels to heaven? That has been the teaching of our church historically. But it could be more like a stadium. So, Mother Teresa kind of has first row seats. And then I'm under like the nosebleed section. But at least we're in the arena. Right? And they describe it as like a glass. So there are big glasses and small glasses, but all the glasses are full. So there's nothing lacking in you. You might have less capacity to love God because you had less during your life. But in heaven, you're completely filled to the brim with the love of God. So nobody in the nosebleeds is going, oh man, I wish I was down there by Mother Teresa. We're up in the nosebleeds going, I'm in! And basically what we know is, eye has not seen, ear has not heard, nor has the heart of man conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. And that's pretty good news. Final questions? Yes. Dead people speak with us. Well, we got the Virgin Mary, but that's the Virgin. And then, there's like mystic revelations of the saints and things. So there are obviously certain exceptions, but in general, the dead don't typically communicate with us because God doesn't sort of misplace their souls or grant them travel. I mean, they're to be at rest, and they're happy, they're good to go, they're in heaven, and follow, is there a reason you're asking that, or anything else you want to share? If they became saints, could they? Yeah. Well, here's the deal. It happens with such frequency that people will say things like, you know, my son collected dimes when he was living, and then he died in a car accident. And every once in a while, I'll find like a dime on my armchair, or I'll find a dime in my cup holder in my car. And I just know that's him telling me, I'm okay, I'm good to go, you can be happy. And if you think I'm gonna stand in front of this crowd and say, no, that doesn't happen, I'm not gonna do that. It happens with such frequency that there's gotta be something to it. The other thing I can tell you is that the church doesn't have an official teaching on it, so I'd just be making it up if I were standing up here, you know, saying that. So there's gotta be something to that. Yes. But not you. Do martyrs go straight to heaven? Again, I bet they go through purgatory a lot faster than other people. But still, they want to be purified just like everybody else. And so if your love of God has convicted you so intensely that you give your life for the faith, well, then you're probably already pretty pure to some degree, and you might pass through purgatory a lot quicker. Oh, sorry. No. Yeah. I'm going to do a last question. It's like 8:45. You've already done your purgatory time for tonight. What about like a young, what about like a high school, any high schoolers want to do like a...
Like a what?
Okay. Not young, anybody?
Father, I'll make this quick.
Okay.
If perchance I was in the hospital or in an accident and there wasn't a priest available and I had, let's say, this is hypothetical, a mortal sin on my soul, if I said, dear God, I'm truly sorry from the bottom of my heart and say a perfect act of contrition and pass away, what's the situation for me?
Thanks, everybody. If you're in the hospital, you have a mortal sin on your soul, a priest is not able to make it. You did try to get a priest, but he's stuck in traffic. On Randall Road.
Full circle.
Yeah, that's good. So if I ever cut any of you off, I'm going to presume I'm on my way to the hospital. Hey, did I tell you guys my Randall Rhodes story about me behaving in a very unchristian manner? All right, I'll get back to them. I got to tell the story. So I had my collar on even, and I'm driving down Randall Road, and this, like, minivan cuts me off. And I'm in touch of the road rage, so I was really upset. But I also saw that the bumper sticker said, Holy Apostles McHenry. So in one of my more prideful moments, I was like, I got my collar in. I want this Catholic to know they just cut off a priest. So I'm trying to like catch up. And so this car's bobbing and weaving, and I'm cutting off like 10 cars on the way up to get to that one car. And so finally, we're side by side. I'm gaining, and I get up there, and I look over with this look on my face, and there's another priest. That...
so good.
In whenever we're trying to avail ourselves of the sacrament of confession and we're unable, even in the case of mortal sin, God doesn't hold that against us. But we do have to, at some level, be seeking it out. You know, we have to desire it, want to get to it. We remember that it's still that God that is looking for the hanging of the Sacred Heart picture on the wall. Anything he can do to give us his mercy, he will. We just can't be resistant to that. We have to couple that with saying, again, the sacrament of confession is not pointless, you know. It's not as if we'll say, well, you know, if it's possible I could be forgiven of an act of contrition, maybe I'll go that route. All right? Heaven, it's a great place, wonderful. Thanks for this. Was, you know, we don't have these kind of crowds on Monday, so. Thanks a lot for coming. The Lord be with you. And Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Great to see you, everybody.